Okay, so Rakesh, because this is the first time you're joining, I'll just give you a brief introduction as to where we are. Okay, last session we purely talked about what our approach will be, and today we will talk a little more or little further about what our approach will be. Okay, and I mean, on the slide you can see that we are talking about sermon preparation. Enduku anante, my emphasis is always on sermon preparation, not in delivery. Because style is not important, substance is important. And in fact, the inspiration for that is from 1 Corinthians chapter 2, wherein we read Paul saying, "I came to you not with excellency of speech or man's wisdom." Okay, because he says he did not want to set the cross of Christ at naught, the power of Christ at naught. So we will take the same inspiration and we will try to focus more on the content or the substance rather than on style. Okay, and my preference is always towards expository preaching, meaning even when I deliver a topical sermon, I try to pick a passage which will talk to that occasion or to that specific subject, and then I'll expose the passage. So that's how I approach, and probably that is the best approach I can recommend, because thereby we will be more biblical and we will be less error-prone. Okay, so that is the approach we'll be taking. And here I've talked about what today's agenda is. Without once again talking about the agenda, I think we can continue so that in the course of conversation, you will understand what our agenda is anyway, right? All right, so let's move to our first stage, wherein we're talking about four different stages of learning. And the reason why we talk about the stages of learning is because these are very distinctly observable. And because they are distinctly observable, at every stage you can assess yourself where you might be, and thereby you can understand what kind of attitude and what kind of approach you need to be exhibiting. Okay, now there are four stages wherein, from the slide, you can understand initially you will not know what you don't know, therefore you feel that you are incompetent. But later, when the theory is given to you, when you've gone through any session for that matter, not just these sessions, but anything you learn in your life, because the theory is covered, you know what you don't know. Nevertheless, you have not done, therefore, you don't feel yourself to be competent. Therefore, you feel you are consciously incompetent. However, the third stage is the instructions which you have learned, you can apply, and thereby you can feel that you are seeing success, and that stage is called consciously competent. And at that stage, you might sometimes be successful, and sometimes you might not be successful. So when you're successful, you feel you're competent, but when you're not successful, you will be disappointed. So understanding where exactly you are will help you not to get disappointed and discouraged, and thereby you will not withdraw, and you can continue to persevere. Okay, and final stage is where you're conscious or unconsciously competent. The best example I always give is about driving. When you're driving, suddenly someone comes in front of you will not push the gas pedal, or you will not think whether you should push the gas pedal or whether you should push the brake. You will automatically do it because it became second nature for you. That is when you are unconsciously competent. And I wanted to talk about this because we will be learning 12 skills. And each of those skills, with practice, you will acquire competence. And you will reach one stage wherein, without any effort, you will be able to go through the exercises, and thereby you can prepare the content necessary for your sermon delivery. Okay, that is the assurance I'm giving you. So that is the confidence with which I wanted to start our session today, because if we lose confidence, then we lose everything. As long as we don't lose our confidence, we will persevere. Any questions? Okay. All right. So if that is the case, then what is expected? I wanted to talk about the different attitudes that need to be existed or existing or exhibited during the first three stages. First and foremost, you have to have patience. Okay, you have to have patience both with yourself and with me. Okay, because you might be learning something, and you might be saying, "Okay, Sajjan, maybe because of the years of experience you have, maybe it is easy for you. For me, it is not easy." No, don't come to that conclusion. my assurances are not without basis because I also went through these stages. Okay, so you have to be patient with me and you have to be patient with yourself. And secondly, you have to be patient because at times you might be seeing competence, you might be seeing successful, it might be encouraging you. At times, you might get discouraged because you have not done what you thought you actually knew. And therefore, you might get discouraged. So you will require to have patience with yourself, both when you are successful and when you are not successful as well. Because when you are successful, don't assume that you have learned everything. Okay, maybe it is just consciously competent stage. Another approach or another attitude that is necessary is you have to be coachable all through. Because as I said, there might be stages when you think you know. And you might even think that you know a few things better than what I'm trying to teach you. Okay, in hospitality or in cooking, there is a saying. Okay, you can create your own recipe. But before you create your own recipe, you have to first learn how to cook. Okay, so have patience, learn how to cook. I'll teach you how to cook. After that, if you become Guruvanu Minchina Shishudu, I'll be glad for that. Okay, that is exactly why I take pains to prepare and present this material. Okay, so I want you to become more competent, more efficient, more useful in God's kingdom than even me, if God willing. Okay, so you may attain a stage wherein you can teach me. I hope that will happen. But till then, be coachable. Okay, and then we have to have hard work. Okay, without hard work, there is no fruit. In fact, Bible itself encourages us, or God through the Bible encourages us that we have to carry what? We have to carry? I need help here. I don't know. We have to carry our crosses and follow Jesus, right? So we have to carry our cross. And secondly, Paul says he sacrifices himself daily. And that's how he follows Jesus. So when we are serving God, you have to expect there is hard work involved, and don't get discouraged because there is so much of work. Because ultimately, you are storing up treasures in heaven. You are being laborers in his vineyard. Okay? And finally, persistence is required. As I said, the model which we are looking, or the approach we will be taking, is hands-on experience, and also will be using a lot of modeling. I'll be doing a lot of work with you so that I show you how things are done and you will be practicing them. So it requires a lot of persistence. Any questions? All right. If not, this slide is meant only for a recap. I don't intend to spend a lot of time on this, but at a high level, I just wanted to once again talk about what I mean by expository preaching, or what are the various definitions for expository preaching. Okay, first and foremost, it is the authorial intent, meaning we have to bring out the intention of the author. We need to find out what the intentions of the author are based on the text we are reading, and we have to bring that out. And the second way of looking at expository preaching is we have to let the text speak again. Again is the key word here, because it already spoke. Okay, God spoke through the word of God, right? God in sundry times spoke in various ways, and now he spoke through his son Jesus Christ. And that is recorded in the Bible. Therefore, God already spoke to us. Now we should let God speak again through our sermons, or we should let the text speak again. And the third way of looking at expository preaching is analysis in all its particulars. In fact, we spent a little more time last week, but we'll try to look at those later. We will definitely look at those later. Therefore, at this point, I will just mention that we should approach the text as if we are a detective with a microscope. We examine every word, in every particular, every detail, and that, in other words, is also called inductive study. Okay, we'll talk a little more about that when we get to another slide. And then we take into consideration the structure and the genre, because the way we interpret poetry will be a little different from the way we interpret prose. And even within the prose, there may be narration, meaning all the gospels of narrative text, whereas all the epistles are situational or contextual. So we need to understand the difference of the genre, and thereby the way we interpret the text will also change. And finally, every sermon that we deliver, every Bible study which we lead, every teaching we do to our children, in our home to our wife, or maybe you're just discussing in a very informal environment, still our purpose is always to generate or extract faith response, or that should be the approach we take. Never bring the glory to ourselves, but always deflect the glory to God. Okay, so that's the approaches we'll be taking as far as expository preaching is concerned. Any questions? Especially Rakesh, you might have questions, but maybe we the way we can resolve that is you can look at the video which I have recorded and uploaded to my website.
Sure, నాకు ముందుగానే మీరు ఈ టీచింగ్ అంతా చేశారన్న, సో ఐ కెన్
రైట్
డిడ్ సమ్ వర్క్ షాప్స్ అండ్ ఆల్ దట్ అండ్ వర్క్డ్ ఆన్ ఇట్ ఫర్
ఓకే ఆల్ రైట్ గుడ్
ఐ విల్ లిసన్ టు ద వీడియో ఇఫ్ ఐ హావ్ ఎనీ
షూర్ గుడ్ ఆల్ రైట్ సో కంటిన్యూయింగ్ ఫర్దర్ స్కిల్ డెవలప్మెంట్ అప్రోచ్ ఇంతకు ముందే చెప్పినాను కదా మై అప్రోచ్ విల్ బి మోర్ టువర్డ్స్ hands-on experience and hands-on practice. But again, I'm not using my own techniques, or I'm not getting the approach from myself, but it is from the book which I'm following, 12 Essential Skills for Great Preaching. Okay, so the approach I'll be taking is, if you know why something has to be done, you will know how it needs to be done. Okay, that is the approach we'll be taking. Meaning, concepts behind the skill. If we understand the concepts behind the skill, we will also automatically know how they need to be done. So that will be one of the approaches we will be taking. And as I said, understand why and you will remember how. Okay, and secondly, modeling of the skills is very essential. So you need to look at good examples, and that will help you to know how we can also approach. And that is why I was talking about one text we will be looking at, one exposition which Jesus himself did will become an example for us. And secondly, when we're talking about modeling, instructions with examples will be the best way for us to go. So I will do the exercises in your presence so that you will understand how we approach those skills. And finally, it requires hands-on approach, meaning I will require each of you to work on it. I mean, consider this to be something like an art or a craft, wherein unless you work with the material, you will not know how exactly that material takes that shape or form. Say, for example, a painter. I mean, you can go for any theoretical lessons regarding painting, but unless you do the painting yourself, you will not know how to do painting. Or say, for example, if you are doing sculpting, okay, unless you work with the material, you will not know how the sculpting actually works. And that is the reason why we say hands-on experience is necessary. And also our material is nothing but words and ideas in the text. Okay, so that is the material which we will be using, and we will require hands-on experience. Okay, and preacher, we need to also understand, preacher is a word crafter. Okay, so you will take all the words which are there and you will craft it in a shape that will become your sermon. Okay, or maybe your teaching content. Therefore, a preacher is also called a word crafter. All right, now continuing, as I said, we will look at one example and understand how Jesus did the exposition. Okay, and the context is, Pharisees asked Jesus, not Pharisees, actually, the Sadducees. They asked Jesus, they wanted to trap Jesus and prove that Jesus is not knowledgeable, or maybe he's not really sent from God. So Sadducees came, and this, they sent lawyers, or those people who are experts in law. They came to Jesus and they told him a story. And the story is, there were seven brothers among us. Okay, the older brother married and he died without children. You remember this parable or this question? Okay, so seven brothers were there. Older brother married and he died without children. So according to the law, the next brother married that lady and he also died without children. That way, all seven of them had her for a wife, and all of them died without children. So when we go to heaven, who will be the husband for this lady? That was the question. But they were trying to ask Jesus whether there is resurrection or not, because the Sadducees do not believe in resurrection. Okay, so they were trying to trap Jesus. And Jesus' response is what we see in these two verses. In fact, we will only look at 31 and 32. And first of all, Jesus started off by saying, but as touching the resurrection, meaning he responded about the question in other aspects, but now he's particularly addressing the resurrection. And he says, but as touching resurrection of the dead. Okay, first of all, what he did is he clarified that in heaven, we don't marry and we don't give in marriage. Okay, so we are like angels. That's what he said. And then he's clarifying about the resurrection, and he says, as touching the resurrection of the dead, have you not read that which was spoken unto you by God, saying, okay, understand here. Here, Jesus is saying, God spoke to you by saying, okay? And he said, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. That is what God said, right? And from that, Jesus brought this conclusion. What you see in red letters is the conclusion. He says, God is not the God of the dead, but of the living. So how did Jesus get the idea that God is the God of living based on this statement? When you examine, okay, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. They are all dead. Right? So if God is the God of the living, then these people are dead. So he's God of the dead, not God of the living. But because there is resurrection, these people, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, have already resurrected. And therefore, God was able to say, I am the God of Abraham, without being God of dead. He's God of living, and still he's saying, I am the God of Abraham and God of Isaac and God of Jacob. Okay, so the whole idea is coming just from this verb, am, the word am, I am. Okay, based on that one single word, Jesus was able to conclude and say there is resurrection. Because am means present tense. God is not saying, I was the God of Abraham. He's saying, I am the God of Abraham. So if God is the God of Abraham, I am in the present tense, that means Abraham is alive today. That means resurrection is already in the past for Abraham. It's in the past for Isaac. It's in the past for Jacob. Make sense? Isn't it profound? That is the reason we have to take every word. If the word of God is inspired word of God, if it is inspired by the Holy Spirit, okay, then every word in every particular detail, every dimension becomes very important because it is the word of God. And actually, when we consider some of the faith statements we have, we say it is verbally inspired, meaning every word is literally inspired. And actually, this is where I wanted to go back to your question, Brother Nathan. You were asking the question, if you're talking about the words, if words have such significance, now we see words have such significance. Yes? Right. If words have such significance, is it important for us, or don't you think it is necessary? Yes, absolutely. It is necessary for us to examine every kind of word. But here is part of the faith statement. Sometimes people add a clause and say, in its original language, in its original text. Okay, so in case of New Testament, the original Greek books are inspired by God. That's how people try to elaborate it further. However, we do not hold to the belief that unless we read it in Greek text, only then we actually understand or we are reading the Word of God. Even if we are reading the English translation, we believe that there is inspiration in the English translation also, because we are not. We are particularly talking about the ideas which are there in every word. So if you are able to port that translation from Greek to English, okay, if you are able to like translate a word from Greek to English, then you have preserved the meaning. You have not lost the meaning, right? Therefore, words become very important, and that is the reason I was recommending use always word-to-word translations. Don't use thought-to-thought translations for sermon preparation. When you're delivering the sermon, for delivery's sake, you can use any translation, especially if you want to make the audience feel comfortable, you can use the latest translation for preaching. But for your own personal study, use always the word-to-word translations, which are King James, New King James, New American Standard, or American Standard, and even to some extent, NIV. And as I said, don't use the TNIV, use the previous versions. ESV is also a good version. Because when you consider the translation also, you might see that words might be placed in different order, or maybe for one particular word, there might be several words we can use in translation. So whether you pick one word over the other is the choice which human beings made, and that's how you have translations. Okay, so we don't need to be too hung up on which translation we should be using, as long as it is a word-to-word translation. Make sense? Okay, let's see further about this exposition. Okay, what are the things which Jesus took into consideration? He took his own time into consideration, because he is aware by now the patriarchs are all dead. Okay, and by now the patriarchs are also alive. So he took his own time into consideration, and he took into consideration when this was written or when this statement was made by God. Okay, and he also took into consideration his own audience. His audience were aware of the fact that God said this to Moses. God said, I am the God of Abraham and the God of Isaac and the God of Jacob. And God said this to Moses. So Jesus was aware of that, and Jesus was also aware that the audience, or his audience, knew this fact. Okay, and he took into consideration the genre also. He did not interpret this figuratively. He did not say, it is possible spiritually. But he took it literally, because this is a narrative. Okay, so he did not try to spiritualize it. Instead, he took it as a literary statement. I am the God. I am, in the present tense, God of Abraham. Okay, and then he took into consideration the fact that the patriarchs were dead, and the audience knew it, he knew it also, and he considered, or he concluded, the patriarchs are presently resurrected, and that is all based on the word am. And finally, he concluded, patriarchs are living, therefore there is resurrection. First tense? Okay, so this is the extent to which we need to analyze. This is the extent to which we analyze the particulars. Okay, how do we do that? We'll come to that. Okay, and again, like, you know, I want to just give that assurance once again. This is the extent we will gain the competence. Okay, but there are 12 stages we need to go through, 12 skills we need to go through. Have patience, be coachable, be hardworking. You will get there. All right. Now, in this slide, we will talk about the approach we'll be taking to expository preparation. And the first approach we will be taking, or the first approach I would call, is inductive Bible study. I talked about inductive and deductive. What is the difference between these two? Okay. Now, inductive Bible study is you will observe carefully the details, and from those details, you will arrive at a universal principle that is called the inductive Bible study. Say, for example, like, you know, you are studying squirrels. Okay, you are studying gray squirrels, and you have studied thousands of them. And in each of those cases, you have seen that they were able to climb the tree. Therefore, based on observation of thousand squirrels, you have come to the conclusion that gray squirrels have the ability of climbing the tree. Okay, so you are observing the particulars, and from that, you're coming out with a universal truth. All right. On the other hand, when you're talking about deductive study, you have a general truth in your mind. a general assumption you have in your mind, a general philosophy you have in your mind, and you're trying to look at the particulars through that lens. Say, for example, like, you know, India, we have a lot of superstitions, right? Okay, so say, for example, if you're walking on the street, and this actually happened to me. Okay, I was going to Chennai to join a new job, and one lady came across. She walked against me. Naaku edru vachindi. Etta edru vachindi? Kali kunda vadukoni vachindi. Okay, empty pot. She was carrying an empty pot. So the conclusion which was given about that incident is, are Sajan pothunnadu gaani uttigo ostadu. Enduku anante kali kunda vadukoni vachindi aadame. Muttaidu. Right? So they have a philosophy in mind. And in fact, in that particular case, I actually failed in my first job and I came return empty. So later they recalled and said, nu poyeta appude anukunnam Sajjan, nu pothunte ada kali kunda pattukoni vachindo kaam. Okay, so they have a philosophy, and looking at the particulars, they are interpreting those particulars from the lens which they are having. Okay, so that is the danger we should be avoiding. And that is why we say here, we carefully examine and analyze, and we try to bring out the authorial intent. Deductive study, on the other hand, would be, we look at particulars with a general idea or assumption. Superstitions, judgments too quickly. We should never conclude anything too quickly. We should not look at the passage and say, okay, this is it. This is what it is talking about. We have to examine all the particulars, and from that we need to bring out the universal truth. Okay, and text to sermon. This is also one important approach we will be taking, and that is, like, you know, we examine all the keywords, as I mentioned earlier also, and the text should speak through our sermon. That is how we will be taking, or that is the approach we'll be taking. And we will also be observing the rhetorical elements. What are rhetorical elements? There are four elements. In fact, when you consider the Bible itself, Bible also is written, or like any book for that matter, you will see that there are ideas, and people or the author will be flowing from one idea to another idea. So it is a sequence of ideas put together, and there you can understand that the author is starting somewhere and he is moving towards some conclusion. Right? The same way, rhetorical elements like explanation, there might be explanation in the passage, there might be illustration in the passage, there might be argumentation in the passage, there might be application in the passage. So we try to examine those, and even our approach also will be such that we will be giving explanation to the text, explanation about the text, we will be giving illustrations, we will be talking about arguments why that principle is truth, or that truth which we have discovered is true, and then we will also bring about an application with that. So these will be the four elements we will be considering. And finally, we need to understand sermon delivery is by definition oral. Okay, so yeah, we might get tempted to use a lot of media these days, because everywhere you see there is media being used. In fact, there is one church which I've very often attended, wherein they don't make any announcements any longer. Instead, the way you have advertisements in TV or in movies, that is how they, announcements are also produced, meaning there is production for announcements, but there is no announcements. So all the human elements are eliminated because there is revolution in media. Now, it might be applicable for anything, but it cannot be applicable for preaching. Preaching is always oral. Any questions? Okay, so based on this, you can see, this is an outline we have discussed last week also. So without going into the details, we can see there is an overall outline for a sermon, and there will be specific outlines for each of the divisions also. And each of the divisions, you can see there is a transition, illustration, meaning, argument, application, conclusion. The four elements which we have talked about here in the rhetorical elements is what we will be seeing or reusing here. Okay. Even Srini, you dropped off and rejoined? Okay. Anyway, you're on mute.
Yeah, I thought that's an audio thing. That's why.
Okay. All right. So finally, I wanted to give you one, quick look for text analysis. And the reason I wanted to give this is, like, you know, sometimes, I mean, like, we go through a lot of study, right? So we go through 12 stages or 12 exercises or 12 skills. And after the 12 skills, you have come up with a sermon. Now, a lot of that might be there in your head, but you might require some triggers to help you to understand what you should be talking about. So, I mean, like, you know, a table like this will be helpful for you, meaning, like, you know, here you can capture everything in a single page. And therefore, if you just have this one single page, you can take this one single page and deliver a sermon. Okay, so like, you know, if you're having a 10-page content, you don't need to have all the 10 pages in front of you, because again, like, we need to also remember sermon delivery also should be inspirational. Therefore, you yourself should be listening to the Holy Spirit and allow the Holy Spirit to dynamically change your vocabulary. Okay, so for that reason, what we do is we have this one single page document, and using this one single page document, we should be able to deliver the sermon. We'll talk about sermon delivery later once we learn all the 12 skills. Okay, any questions at this stage? All right, we'll go into each of these these fields more in detail. Therefore, let us not worry too much at this point how these fields have to be filled. All right, now advantages of inductive study. Here again, I'll not spend much of time. I'll try to quickly move, because I see that we are already at 9:21 according to my cell phone. So we'll try to conclude in 1 hour, because we joined on time. We'll try to conclude on time. Okay, so the advantages of inductive Bible study is, even when we are not inspired, we will be able to continue working on the text, and there that means you are not waiting for an inspiration or a stimulation. Instead, you start working on the text, and based on your study, you will discover some things in the Bible, and that will become your inspiration, and that will ignite your inspiration, and that's how you can continue to work even when you are not feeling inspired. Because, see, the text is always inspired. You may be inspired or not at that moment. You may be going through some down, conditions wherein emotionally you're not very elated. But even in that circumstances, you can continue working on the text. Okay, if we understand how to do inductive study. And then we also need to always understand, many a times we Christians discount ourselves as preachers. We always think that we are not able or we are not capable, mainly because we do not understand few things, and that is, God's word is a revelation. God gave this word to us, the Bible to us, in order to understand him. God spoke through his word, right? So the purpose of Bible itself is to reveal to us. It is not for us to, the word of God to be concealed from our knowledge. Okay, so it is not for exclusive circle of scholars, and we can be certain that we are all qualified. Okay, and the third advantage for inductive study is, we will be depending on scripture alone. We are not depending on people. We are not depending on the ideas of the society. Okay, we are not bringing in all the worldly knowledge and worldly wisdom into our study. Instead, we are letting the text speak, and only the Bible will be speaking to us. Begin with what the text actually says, and we are not depending on what someone else is saying, right? And finally, we are more receptive to the Holy Spirit, because the Word of God is inspired by the Holy Spirit. And also, from John chapter 16, verse 13, we read, when he, meaning the Holy the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. This is the promise Jesus gave us. Okay, so the Holy Spirit will guide us. Therefore, if we are relying only on the Word of God, then the Holy Spirit will have greater control over us to guide our study, and thereby we will be more receptive to the Holy Spirit. And here we need to understand, the Holy Spirit inspired the scripture, and also Holy Spirit illumines the reader. Okay, any questions? All right. So if there are no questions, then what I'll do is, because we are at 9:24, maybe it would be not right for us to start another topic. Instead, I'll just give you a brief idea as to what I plan to cover in the next session. Okay, so this is the next session wherein we'll try to do an exercise, not one exercise. In fact, we will be doing two different exercises. One, we will try to learn how to pick a pericope or a sermon for, or a text for the sermon. And we will also try to do what is called a structural diagram. Okay, a structural diagram will give us a lot of insights, and just I'll give a quick peek for you so you understand, like, you know, how a structural diagram looks like. Okay, so we rewrite the passage in a way that it will help us to identify all the main ideas. Say, for example, here you have these three as your main ideas. Because you have rewritten the text in a structural diagram, you will be able to easily identify what are the main ideas in this text. Okay, and as you see here, these are the three ideas, and the basis for that is you are looking at what are the supporting ideas and what are the main ideas, and the bigger the supporting ideas, or when you have more supporting ideas, you can consider that idea to be the main idea. Okay, and also when you look at this when you consider has begotten, we'll talk more about this, but when you consider this as the main idea, what are the supporting ideas? Those supporting ideas will become your argumentation for the main idea. Meaning they are describing, or they are giving argumentation, they are giving reasons why this idea is true. Right? That way, when you rewrite this, rewrite a text in a structural diagram, from this itself, as you can see, almost your sermon is built from this. Make sense? We'll go into the details next week. We'll try to conclude now. Before we conclude, any comments? Now you can unmute your mics. Yeah, I think if you're not volunteering, I know Nathan, you're trying to talk, so I'll give you the first chance.
Well, I'm trying to figure out, Brother Sajjan, about the structure, how to divide and all. You said you'll cover more detail on that next week.
Yeah, I'm just giving you a sneak peek. Okay, you will do this, or we will go through this, and then we will do an exercise together, and then I will give you. Okay, so I just wanted to show this slide to give you an inspiration to join next panel. And this is a marketing strategy. All right. Because you're not volunteering, I'll call on each of you. Rakesh, your comment.
No comment.
Okay, questions?
Questions, thought translation and literal translation.
Yeah.
So you are suggesting a literal translation while preparing for sermons.
Yes.
But is it not good to ever look at the thought translations? Or, literal translations, okay, fine, because even literal translations could have English lo proper literal translate, and words could have, like, we have to go back to Greek or Aramaic,
right. So I already know what is your Greek lopala, Aramaic lopala, panditunu ayipoyinattunnu kada.
Adi manaku raadu kaabatti adugutunnanu.
No, actually, that is one of the tools which I will be giving you, Rakesh. So we'll start with English. Until, like, you know, the premise we are using is, God knows how to preserve His word. And God knows how to transmit His word from one generation to another, and how to transmit the word to all the nations, because He wants everyone to come to faith, come to knowledge of Him. Right? So using English translation also, we can. However, as you said, there might be some words which, with every translation, there could be a loss of meaning. Particularly because the word construction itself will be different in some cases. Say, for example, in Greek, double negative doesn't become positive. Okay, whereas in English, a double negative becomes positive. Right? That way, there are certain constructions which we will need to examine. Kadupote, there are tools for us. I'll talk about those tools also when we are talking about research. Okay, we'll go through, like as I said, we have 12 skills to learn. One is your structural diagram. Second, immediate observation. Third, you will ask imperative questions, and those questions will lead you to research, and that research will end you up in some of those aspects about how in the original in the original language how that construction might have come. We have commentaries for that. I'll guide you to some of those. Okay. And no Greek nerchukuntan ante nenu oddanu anu
first me papa per nerchukuna adhe na first
I know. Yeah, in fact I love Greek. I'll teach you also how it is possible for us to learn Greek. Endukante, see, you remember that 80-20 principle probably you learned in your secular jobs, 80-20 principle. Right? 20% of your knowledge, with 20% of your knowledge, you can do 80% of your work. Right? So you can learn 20% of Greek and be able to interpret 80% of the New Testament. I'll teach you how to do that. All right. Next, Srini. No gamma nunda ku tappichukoku daasukuntunna enka bench la kusani.
Client ledu. Em question le ledu actually. It's good.
Okay. All right. So next time we'll try to meet again early, and next time, as I told, I'll try to cover two skills. Okay. In fact, that is the first skill is not really considered as a skill, or it's not introduced in the book as a skill, but I think it is a skill too. Therefore, I'll talk about in fact, the approach I will be taking, or the agenda, probably I'll show you the agenda also. So we'll talk about selecting the sermon. We'll talk about how to examine the context or study the context. We will talk about text analysis, not test analysis. Okay, there are three skills required to do the test analysis. And we'll get to the first skill, which is the structural diagram. Okay. All right. I think we are right about 9:31. We just ran 1 minute over, which is, I think, which should be fine. And Rakesh, we have the privilege of you joining us. Therefore, we'll request you to close in prayer.
Sure, Anna. ప్రేమ దగ్గర మా పల్లొక తండ్రి మీకు పాదం స్తోత్రం చెల్లించుకుంటున్నాం నాయన. నా తండ్రి ఈ విధంగా నా తండ్రి నాయన వీడియో కాన్ఫరెన్స్ ద్వారా చేరి నా తండ్రి నాయన మీ యొక్క వాక్యం నా తండ్రి చదువు నా తండ్రి ఎలా చదవాలో నాయన నా తండ్రి నేర్చుకున్నట్టుగా మీరు ఇచ్చిన కృపకే వందనాలు చెల్లించుకుంటున్నాం నా తండ్రి. నా తండ్రి ఈ యొక్క సెషన్ గురించి నా తండ్రి ప్రిపేర్ అవుతున్న సజ్జనాన్ని కూడా మీరు దీవించండి. మీ యొక్క పరిశుద్ధాత్మని నడిపింపును దయచేయండి నా తండ్రి. ఆయన ఆయన ప్రిపరేషన్ అంతట్లోనూ నా తండ్రి మీ హస్తం ముంచుతురమ్మని ప్రార్థిస్తున్నాను. నా తండ్రి వింటున్న మాకు కూడా నా తండ్రి నాయన నా తండ్రి మీరే పరిశుద్ధాత్మని ద్వారా నా తండ్రి మాట్లాడుతూ రమ్మని ప్రార్థిస్తున్నాం నాయన. నా తండ్రి విన్న ప్రతి విషయంలో నా తండ్రి మా యొక్క జీవితంలో అనువయించుకున్నట్టుగా నా తండ్రి నాయన ప్రాక్టీస్ చేయనట్టుగా నా తండ్రి నాయన మమ్మల్ని కూడా నా తండ్రి మీరు ఇన్స్పైర్ చేస్తారమని ప్రార్థిస్తున్నాం నా తండ్రి. ఆయన మమ్మల్ని అందరినీ నా తండ్రి మరి ఒకసారి నా తండ్రి చేర్పించిన ఆయన నా తండ్రి నెక్స్ట్ సెషన్ లో కూడా నా తండ్రి నాయన చేర్చి నా తండ్రి నాయన మీ యొక్క వాక్ మీ యొక్క నా తండ్రి యొక్క సిరీస్ నా తండ్రి కంటిన్యూ చేస్తారమని నా తండ్రి యొక్క చిన్న ప్రార్థనను చేసే నామం నడి వేడుకొంచుతున్నాం తండ్రి.
ఆమేన్.
Thank you, Rakesh, for your prayer. And once again, marketing, akadikada nenu marketing material introduce chestunnanu. Effort anta waste gaani akandi. Okay, continue your momentum. You have started a good work. Okay. Keep it up. And once again, to remind biblically, karyarambam kante karyantam shreshtam. So keep your eyes on the goal and let us persevere with patience. All right.
Thank you. Thank you, Brother Sajjan, for all your time preparation. Thank God for you.
Yeah, that's God-given privilege, and I'm glad to do that, Brother Netha.
Brothers, have a wonderful week ahead, and we'll catch up next Sunday.
You too, Brother. Thank you all. Good night.
Thank you, Anna.
Good night. God bless. Yeah.